সবাইকে শুভ পঞ্চমীর শুভেচ্ছা। আজকে আমাদের ডক্টর সোনালী সরকারের দ্বিতীয় ক্লাস এবং প্রবাবলি পুজোর আগে এটা আমাদের শেষ ক্লাস। তো আর ইন্ট্রোডাকশনের বিশেষ কিছু নেই, এটা কন্টিনিউয়েশন ক্লাস। সো আই হ্যান্ড ওভার দ্য পোডিয়াম টু ডক্টর সোনালী সরকার অ্যান্ড ওয়েলকাম অল অন বিহাফ অফ ফেডারেশন অফ ইউনাইটেড ডক্টর্স অনলাইন ক্লাস।
Today is our second class. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Today is our second class, examination of heart part 2. And today we will be dealing with the auscultation part. Stethoscope, you all know, it was constructed by French physician René Théophile Hyacinthe Lenet in 1826. I am not going into the details of the stethoscope, but what are the prerequisites for having a stethoscope? The bell of the stethoscope should be at least 1 inch in diameter, and it is mostly used for the detection of low frequency heart sounds and murmurs. It is very soft, faint heart sounds and murmurs will be picked up by the bell of the stethoscope. And how should we use it? We should use it with the lightest possible contact pressure. Don't press it on the patient's chest wall tightly. What will happen if you press it tightly? The bell will now act like a diaphragm. So it will no longer pick up the low frequency or the soft murmurs, and it will only pick up the high frequency or the loud murmurs. So it will not help you in the original purpose for which it is designed. But the diaphragm of the stethoscope should be at least 1.5 inch in diameter, and it is used for the detection of high frequency heart sounds and murmurs. And the diaphragm should be used with firm pressure. Why? Because the firm pressure will now remove the low frequency murmurs, will be filtered out, and you will be better able to hear the high frequency sounds. So the bell of the stethoscope should be used with low pressure, and the diaphragm of the stethoscope should be used with firm pressure. Now, what are the classic precordial sites of auscultation? We all know the aortic area, the right second intercostal space, the pulmonary area, the left second intercostal space, the apex, mitral area of the apex is the left fifth intercostal space, where we are finding the apex, that are just medial to the midclavicular line. And the tricuspid area is the parasternal region in the lower left parasternal region in the fourth or fifth left intercostal space. So the aortic area, right second intercostal space. We have another area which is known as the neoaortic area or the ERBS area. This is the third left intercostal space. Pulmonary area in the second left intercostal space. Tricuspid area, we have already told, left sternal border, fourth and fifth. Mitral area at the apex, in the axilla for what are the other areas that we listen to? The axilla for radiation of pan-systolic murmur of mitral regurgitation. On the back, the infrascapular area. In the last class, we talked about Sussman sign, that is the presence of arterial collaterals in the back. So at the same coarctation of aorta, in the same region, if you put your stethoscope, you can also hear the murmurs of coarctation of aorta. It is the interscapular area, the infrascapular area, or over the spine. So you can also auscultate the anterior chest on the right side in case of dextrocardia. We have to auscultate over the carotids for the conduction of systolic murmur of aortic valve disease, and above and below the clavicles for the characteristic continuous murmur of PDA. You also auscultate the epigastrium. In which cases, last class we saw that we will inspect and palpate the epigastrium mostly in patients of COPD. So the same is true here also. Mostly in patients with COPD, that is emphysematous patients, we auscultate the epigastrium for a tricuspid regurgitation murmur.
It's a good one.
And over the peripheral arterial sites, over the femorals, where the murmurs of aortic regurgitation, peripheral murmurs of aortic regurgitation can be heard. Now, what is the method of auscultation? It is known as the inching method. That is, you auscultate first at the apex and the left axilla, move to the lower left sternal area, then progress along the sternal border as you move up. So, the first will be the new aortic area, which is the third left intercostal space. Then you move up to the second left intercostal space, which is the pulmonary area. Then go to the right second intercostal space, which is the aortic area, and then above and below the clavicles, and then up to the carotids. Now, what is important? How do you identify systole and diastole in a cycle? So, S1 identifies the onset of ventricular systole, and second heart sound identifies the onset of ventricular diastole. So, how do you know which is S1 and which is S2? You listen to the place of stethoscope over the apex and place one finger over a carotid pulse. So, the murmur that you are hearing at the apex, if it coincides with the carotid pulse, that means it is a systolic murmur. And the murmur that you are hearing over the apex that does not coincide with the carotid pulse, that is a diastolic murmur. Similarly, the heart sound that you are listening at the apex, which occurs at the same time as the carotid pulse, is the S1. And the heart sound that you are hearing at the apex with the stethoscope, but it occurs after the carotid pulse, that is S2. So this is the picture how you will auscultate the patient. First at the apex in supine and left lateral position. Then this is the picture of you auscultate at the apex and you place your finger, thumb over the common carotid artery and learn to time the heart sound or the murmur. The heart sound and the murmur that occur at the same time as the carotid artery pulse are systolic. And the heart sound and the murmur that do not occur at the same time as the carotid artery pulse is a little later are diastolic. Now, how do you auscultate the base? It's the aortic area. Patient will sit up, patient will lean forward, and the breath will be held in and expiration. Similarly, for the pulmonary area, sitting up and leaning forward with the breath held in and expiration. It's ask the patient, ki bolbe nishchashta chhede deben aur neben na dhore rakhben. Then you place your stethoscope and auscultate it. First, you ask the patient to sit up, then you ask the patient to lean forward slightly. Then you instruct the patient nishchashta chhede diye aur neben na. That is the instruction for auscultating at end expiration. And the instruction for auscultating at inspiration is nishchashta dhore rakhben aur chharben na. And then you auscultate. This auscultation at the tricuspid area in supine position and the right lateral position. And auscultation for tricuspid events with passive leg raising. Since these are or tricuspid area relates to the tricuspid valve. Tricuspid valve is located between the right atria and the right ventricle. You know that all the right-sided heart events, since the right ventricle receives venous blood from the body, so all the right-sided heart events will be increased if you increase venous return to the right heart. So how does it occur? By passive leg raising and by inspiration. So heart sounds, sudden deceleration of blood within the cardiovascular system produces heart sounds. Rapid deceleration of blood initiates vibration of the cardiac structures immediately after the coaptation means closure of the valves. So closure of the valves is mostly responsible for first heart sound and the second heart sound. Now we will go to first heart sound. First heart sound signals the onset of left ventricular contraction. So what are the and others, first heart sound is produced by closure of the atrioventricular valves. So what are the determinants of the intensity of first heart sound? We will come to the structural integrity of the valve, that is the thickness and mobility of the mitral and tricuspid valves, the position of the mitral valve at the onset of systole, what is the myocardial contractility, the transmission characteristics of the thoracic cavity and chest wall. We will go into each of these. First is structural integrity of the mitral valve. Normal mitral valve has thin and pliable leaflets, so it produces a normal sounded S1. But in mitral stenosis, particularly when the mitral valve becomes rigidly calcified, the valve becomes immobile. This results in immobility of the valve, results in diminished or absent first heart sound. But when this valve is thickened but moving very good, that is, it is non-calcified, then it produces a loud first heart sound. Think of a door that we are closing. This door is a mitral valve. If the door is a very thin one, if you closing a thin door will make a soft sound. But if this door becomes a thick one, closing a thick door will produce a louder sound. So that is the same thing. But when this thick door becomes very jammed, you cannot close it any longer. So it will again produce a soft sound. Now, velocity of valve closure. How will you know? Velocity of valve closure depends upon how much the valve is open. Supposing you open the door to a very small extent and then you close it, it will produce a soft sound. But if you open the door very wide and then you close it, it will produce a loud sound. So that is what happens in mitral stenosis. The mitral valves are very wide open. So closing of the valve from a very wide open position will produce a loud sound, and that is why the S1 is loud. Also, the S1 increases in intensity in cases of increased myocardial contractility. What are these? Exercise, thyrotoxicosis, high output states like anemia, pregnancy, AV fistula, fever, and anxiety. Similarly, decreased myocardial contractility, like in acute myocardial infarction, cardiomyopathy, myocarditis, ventricular aneurysm or heart failure, or drug-induced myocardial depression can decrease the intensity of first heart sound. Tachycardia increases intensity of first heart sound, and increased thickness of the thoracic cavity and chest wall, like in obesity, emphysema, large tubal or pericardial effusion. Here, the intensity of the first heart sound will decrease. The thin body habitus will increase the intensity of heart sounds in murmurs. So why is S1 loud in mitral stenosis? S1 is loud in mitral stenosis. First is thickened but mobile leaflets. Two conditions must be fulfilled. It will be thickened, but it should be mobile, that is non-calcified. Second is, what happens in mitral stenosis? The mitral valve is, the mitral valve orifice reduces. So the blood from mitral left atria to left ventricle can go through the mitral valve only if the left atria pushes this blood at a higher pressure. So there is a pressure gradient between the left atria and the left ventricle. This pressure gradient keeps the mitral leaflets wide open at end diastole. So as I am telling you, if you close a door from a wide open position, it will increase the intensity of the increase the sound of door closing. Similarly, since the mitral leaflets are wide open at end diastole, when systole occurs, it closes very rapidly from the wide open position and it produces a loud first heart sound. Now this is a chart showing the factors that cause increase, decrease and variable intensity of the first heart sound. If you try to remember the most important causes, or at least 80 to 90% of them, your exam purpose is solved. Increased first heart sound, first and first cause is mitral stenosis. First and first cause is mitral stenosis, the first answer. Then left atrial myxoma. This option number 3 you may not remember. Then followed by the exercise hyperkinetic circulatory states. Just as mitral stenosis produces loud M1, tricuspid stenosis, since the S1 is formed of both mitral M1 coming from mitral valve and T1 coming from tricuspid valve. So just like mitral stenosis will produce loud M1, tricuspid stenosis will produce a loud T1. Also, it occurs in atrial septal defect. Why? Because in atrial septal defect, there is a blood flows from the left atria to right atria through the defect in the atrial septum. Then the blood flows from the right atria into the right ventricle. So the right ventricle is receiving a lot of blood, more than normal, through the tricuspid valve. Since a high amount of blood is flowing through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle, this produces a functional tricuspid stenosis. Hence, produces a loud T1. So decreased intensity of first heart sound is severe mitral regurgitation, flail mitral reflex, acute myocardial infarction, cardiomyopathy, myocarditis, and of course calcified mitral stenosis. Variable intensity of first heart sound occurs in atrial fibrillation, complete heart block, or ventricular tachycardia with AV dissociation, or atrial tachycardia with varying block. Now the second heart sound. Second heart sound is known as the key to auscultation of the heart, because by just auscultating the second heart sound, you can tell many things about the heart. It is a high frequency sound. It is composed of A2 and P2. The A2 and P2 signal the end of LV and RV ejection. Compared to first heart sound, the second heart sound is higher in pitch and frequency. So how to differentiate between first heart sound and second heart sound? One is first heart sound will be simultaneously coming with the carotid pulse, and the second heart sound will come after the carotid pulse. So A2 is, second heart sound is higher in pitch and frequency. This second heart sound is composed of A2 and P2. A2 is earlier and louder than P2. Why it is louder than P2? Because obviously the pressure on the left heart is higher than the pressure on the right heart. So A2 originates from the aorta, that is the left heart, so A2 is louder and P2 is softer. Where do you normally hear the A2? A normal A2 will be well heard in all the areas of the cardiac precordium, aortic area, the pulmonary area, as well as the apex. But P2 is well audible only at the pulmonary area. Even at the pulmonary area, the P2 is softer than A2. This is a very important point. So what is the take-home points? A2 will be audible in the aortic area, the pulmonary area, and the apex. But the loudest it will be heard in the aortic area. T2 will be heard only at the pulmonary area, and even at the pulmonary area, T2 is softer than A2. And A2-P2 gap is well heard during inspiration and not during expiration. Going into the physiology of the events will make the class very lengthy. It's not possible. So causes of abnormal splitting of the second heart sound. Just have to, I have made a chart, but going into the mechanism and the individual causes will be a very lengthy class. We will have to have only a class on second heart sound then. So wide splitting, we have to remember atrial septal defect as the first cause. Then there is significant mitral regurgitation, ventricular septal defect, left ventricular pacing, and acute pulmonary embolism, pulmonary hypertension with right heart failure. Then reverse splitting, this is LVOT obstruction, right ventricular ectopic pits, PDA, post-aortic dilatation of aorta, hypertensive heart disease. So what is the difference between these things? See, reverse splitting, if you see, all of these events are those that will directly or indirectly cause increase in the LV ejection time. That is LV outflow tract obstruction. So, or a left bundle branch block, or a RV pacing beats, or RV ectopic beats. So any event that causes an increase in LV ejection time will cause a delay in A2. So when A2 is delayed, it comes after P2, that is known as reverse splitting. And what is wide splitting? There is a wide gap between A2 and P2 that is heard during expiration in both supine and upright positions. Why this occurs? Any events that will cause an increase in RV ejection or a decrease in LV ejection will result in wide splitting. So atrial septal defect, there is a lot of blood in the RV, as I said earlier. So the RV takes a longer time to complete its ejection. Hence, P2 is delayed. So there is a wide splitting in ASD. What happens in mitral regurgitation? In mitral regurgitation, as the LV contracts, part of the blood ejects into the aorta and part of the blood ejects into the left atrium. So the LV ejection is shortened because a smaller volume of blood is being ejected. So A2 comes earlier. So this again increases the gap between A2 and P2. Same is for ventricular septal defect. When the LV contracts, part of the blood goes through the LV outflow tract into the aorta and part of the blood goes through the BSD into the right ventricle. So the LV ejection is shortened. So A2 comes earlier. While the RV ejection is prolonged, so P2 comes later than normal. So this increases the A2-P2 gap and results in wide splitting of second heart sound. What happens is acute pulmonary embolism. Acute pulmonary embolism means there is a obstruction to the RV outflow tract, or pulmonary hypertension, there is obstruction to the pulmonary RV ejection. So RV ejection is prolonged, P2 gets delayed than normal, so the A2-P2 gap increases. Hence, there is wide splitting of the second heart sound. Now, P2 is absent. One causes of absent is obesity, thick chest wall, emphysema, and all. Severe pulmonary stenosis. In severe pulmonary stenosis, the valve becomes immobile, so P2 is absent. In TOF, the P2 is absent since the RV is hypertrophic and there is not much flow across the pulmonary valve into the pulmonary arteries. The pulmonary arteries are small. Hence, P2 is absent. Pulmonary attrition, no pulmonary valve, so P2 will be absent. Isis meninges VSD, P2 is absent. Single ventricle, P2 is absent. Similarly, if we use a bit of common sense, you can learn it. The A2 is absent when there is severe aortic stenosis, valves are calcified, not moving, A2 will be absent. Aortic atresia, A2 will be absent. Single ventricle, A2 will be absent. A2 is absent or undetectable. Similarly, but why will be the A2 absent or undetectable in severe pulmonary stenosis or severe pulmonary hypertension? P2 is so loud that you cannot make out A2. That is why it is absent or, so what is also written is undetectable. A2 is present, but you cannot detect it because P2 is very loud. So, increased intensity of A2, any condition that will cause increased flow of blood across the aortic valve will cause increased intensity of AFib, or like hyperkinetic circulatory states, systemic hypertension, or bicuspid aortic valve with no significant aortic stenosis. What happens in bicuspid aortic valve? The aortic valve cusps are thickened, but they are mobile. Just like mitral stenosis, valve cusps are thickened, but they are mobile. Similarly, bicuspid aortic valve valves are thickened, but they are mobile. Hence, it increases the intensity of AFib. Pulmonary atresia, intensity of AFib is increased because the aorta is larger and standing in front. PG also, AFib intensity is increased because in transposition of great arteries, the aorta comes in front. Normally, the aorta is posterior, the pulmonary tract is anterior. Now, decreased intensity of AFib occurs in valvular aortic stenosis or aortic sclerosis, where the valve mobility is poor. What happens to P2? Loud P2 occurs in thin chest wall, straight back syndrome, hyperkinetic circulatory states, because there is increased flow across the pulmonary area. Pulmonary hypertension of any cause will cause increase in P2. Atrial septal defect. Why atrial septal defect? Because high amount of blood moving through the RV will naturally go across the pulmonary valve to the pulmonary arteries. So in atrial septal defect, even without pulmonary hypertension, P2 will be loud. When is the P2 diminished? Yes, these are common reasons: thick chest or obesity, COPD, pulmonary stenosis, decreased movement of the pulmonary valve, dysplastic pulmonary valve. This pulmonary valve is not formed or absent, which occurs in Noonan syndrome, and mild cough. Now, how do you grade a P2? Whether it is mild increase or moderate increase or severe increase? Mild or grade 1, when intensity of P2 is equal to A2 at the pulmonary area, that means it is mild. When the systolic pressure is between 30 to 49, you need not remember the pressures. What is moderate? When the intensity of P2 is more than A2 at the pulmonary area, that is P2 is louder than A2, it is moderate. P2 is equal to A2 at pulmonary area, mild pulmonary hypertension. P2 is louder than A2 at pulmonary area, moderate pulmonary hypertension. Then P2 is loud and banging and audible beyond the pulmonary area, that is severe pulmonary hypertension. So grade 1 and grade 2, P2 is audible at the pulmonary area. When you hear at the pulmonary area only, that P2 is equal to A2, P2 is louder than A2. But when you can hear P2 outside the pulmonary area, then it is severe pulmonary hypertension. What is third heart sound? Third heart sound is a low frequency mid-diastolic sound. Since it is a mid-diastolic sound, when will you be able to hear it? Between S2 and S1. So it will come after the carotid apex. When heard in busy states, it is called as ST gallop. It is best heard, since it is a low frequency sound, you will best hear it in the bell of the stethoscope with at the apex of the heart with the patient in the left lateral position. Now, how do you recognize it? S3, pathological S3 may sometimes be palpable. Like in the last class, I was saying, it feels like the purring of a cat. If you have touched a resting cat, the vibrating feeling that you have on your fingers, you will have the same feeling when you palpate the apex in a patient who has pathological S3. It is heard only with the bell of the stethoscope, as it is a low frequency sound with the lightest possible pressure. When it originates from the LV, you hear it in the left lateral position during expiration. You hear it at the apex in the left lateral position during expiration. When it is RVS3, you hear it in the tricuspid area in the supine position and increase during inspiration. The causes of ST, from our physiological causes, children, young adults, and pregnancy, and pathological causes, number one causes heart failure. Then you have mitral regurgitation gives rise to LVS3, tricuspid regurgitation gives rise to RVS3. Then you have PDA, LVS3, GST, LVS3. Remaining the lower causes you may not remember. And then number 12 you have to remember, which is dilated cardiomyopathy with heart failure. Opening snap. This is very important, since in a long case, you will get a case of mitral stenosis. So you will have to study mitral stenosis and opening snap again and again and again. So opening of the normal atrioventricular valves is noiseless. But when these valves become thickened and deformed, a high frequency clicky sound is generated in early diastole. What is the meaning of early rasturi? You will listen, you will hear it after the second half sound, which is called as opening snap. So what are the prerequisites? Chicken but mobile leaflets. Immobile calcified leaflets, like in severely calcified matrixosis, you will not hear any opening snap. High atrial pressure. As in mitral stenosis, like if you have used a water pipe to water your plants in the garden, if you press the mouth of the pipe, you will feel the water coming out at higher pressure. But when you release the pressure, the water will come at a normal pressure. So it's the same. As the mitral valve orifice decreases, left atria can push the blood into the left ventricle across a small mitral valve orifice area only if it pumps at a higher pressure. So this high pressure is very important for the generation of opening snap. So what is the another theory is that it is the opening snap occurs due to sudden stopping of the opening movement of the valve. And this is what is seen in the echocardiography. The corresponding finding is diastolic doning of the mitral valve during echo. This corresponds to the opening snap. So it's a high frequency sounds, mobile leaflets and high atrial pressure are required for the production of the opening snap. It's a diastolic event, so it comes after second heart sound. That is the A2OS interval varies from 0.03 to 0.15 seconds. We will come into it. Common causes are mitral stenosis and tricuspid stenosis. These are stenotic causes. Remaining causes are non-stenotic, but the snap occurs because of functional stenosis. That is, valve is normal, but high amount of blood is flowing to the valve. So the A2OS interval can clinically predict the left atrial pressure and therefore the severity of mitral stenosis. This interval is inversely proportional to the left atrial pressure. That is, higher the left atrial pressure or more severe the mitral stenosis, earlier the opening snap, that is shorter the A2OS interval. So in mild MS, the A2OS interval is more than 120 milliseconds and a left atrial pressure of 15 millimeters per day. We need to remember the mean. The mean is less than 5. In moderate MS, A2OS interval is 60 to 80 milliseconds. Mean is between 5 to 10. And severe mitral stenosis, the A2OS interval is 40 to 60 milliseconds with a mean more than 10. You cannot measure this, but you can, whether the gap is short or long, can only be learned by repeated auscultation of the patient. There is no other alternative to this. I can only teach you the theory, but the practical, that is repeated auscultation of the patient, there is no other alternative to it. It cannot be reproduced. Whether the gap is short or long depends upon your ear's practice. Now coming to murmurs. Murmurs are produced. There are many theories due to turbulent flow across the valve. So how do you characterize a murmur? If you hear on a murmur on auscultation, what are the further subclassifications of the murmur? How do you characterize it? First is timing of the murmur in relation to the heart sounds. Is systolic, diastolic or continuous? What is the location of the murmur? By location we mean what is the site of maximum intensity? What is the duration or length of the murmur? The loudness of the murmur, that is the grade of the murmur. The frequency or pitch of the murmur, the shape of the murmur, the transmission of the murmur, and dynamic auscultation. So cardiac murmurs are classified according to systolic murmurs. The murmur begins with or after S1 and ends at or before S2. Diastolic murmur will begin with or after S2 and end before the S1. Systole is between S1 and S2, so systolic murmur will occur with or after S1 and will end before S2. Diastole is between S2 and S1, so diastolic murmur will begin with or after S2 and it has to end before the S1. What is a continuous murmur? The murmur begins with systole and continues without interruption through S2 into all or part of diastole. Usually have their peak intensity around S2. Systolic and diastolic murmurs are further subclassified as early, mid, late, or pan. It's pan systolic or pan diastolic. So, how do you time the murmur? One is One method is simultaneous palpation of the right carotid artery. So if the murmur in question, the murmur that is coming at the same time as the carotid artery is systolic, and the murmur that is coming after the carotid artery pulsation is diastolic. Second method is to identify the second heart sound at the base of the heart. Now go to the apex and try to concentrate on the second heart sound. If the murmur comes before the second heart sound, it is systolic. If the murmur comes after the second heart sound, it is diastolic. So first method is palpate the carotid artery. If it comes with the carotid artery, it is systolic. If it comes after the carotid artery pulsation, it is diastolic. Second is identify the second heart sound. At the second heart sound will be loudest at the base of the heart. Now, try to concentrate on the murmur in relation to the second heart sound. That is, what is its relation to the second heart sound? If the murmur comes after second heart sound, it is diastolic. If the murmur comes before second heart sound, it is systolic. Classification according to location of the murmur. Murmurs heard at the apex are the mid-diastolic murmur of mitral stenosis, systolic murmur of mitral regurgitation, and sometimes ejection systolic murmur of calcified aortic stenosis, but not a pneumatic aortic stenosis. Calcified aortic stenosis or degenerative aortic stenosis, murmur is heard at the apex. Pneumatic aortic stenosis, murmur is not heard at the apex. Murmurs at the left sternal border are pan-systolic murmur of DST, early diastolic murmur of aortic regurgitation, ejection systolic murmur of pulmonary stenosis, and murmur of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Murmurs heard at the pulmonary area are ejection systolic murmur of pulmonary stenosis, and flow murmur of ASD, continuous murmur of PDA. Since what are the, you have to visualize what are the structures of the heart that are at the pulmonary area. So, this is the pulmonary artery and the pulmonary valve and the subpulmonary VSD, and a communication between the aorta and the pulmonary artery, that is the PDA. So from the pulmonary valve, there will be a pulmonary stenosis murmur, or there will be a diastolic murmur of pulmonary regurgitation. Flow murmur through the pulmonary artery will come from ASD, and then a continuous murmur of PDA since the ductus lies at that end, or a murmur of subpulmonary VSD since the location of the VSD is just below the pulmonary artery. So the murmur of subpulmonary VSD will be best heard at the pulmonary area. Murmurs at the aortic area are ejection systolic murmur of aortic stenosis and the early diastolic murmur of aortic regurgitation. Murmurs at the tricuspid area will be obviously the mid-diastolic murmur of tricuspid stenosis, and commoner is systolic murmur of tricuspid regurgitation. The intensity or loudness of the murmur, this you will have to learn by heart. It will be asked during this MBBS examinations. What is the intensity? Grade 1 by 6 is the faintest murmur that can be heard only with close concentration under optimal conditions. It's quite soon with a relaxed patient. Grade 2 is a soft or faint murmur that can be readily detected. Grade 3 is a moderately loud murmur, but there is no trill. The moment the murmur has a trill, it becomes a grade 4 murmur. Grade 5 murmur is an extremely loud murmur that can be heard if the stethoscope is in contact with the chest, but cannot be heard if the stethoscope is removed. It is accompanied by a trill. And grade 6 is a very loud murmur, and it can be heard even after the stethoscope has just removed contact from the chest wall. So what is the significance? Grade 3 by 6 or higher murmurs are hemodynamically significant. Grade 1 and grade 2 are mostly functional murmurs in most of the cases, and they do not have any underlying heart disease. So what is a murmur envelope? That is, it is related to the pattern of blood flow velocity. Crescendo means the murmur gradually increases in intensity. The example is ejection systolic murmur of aortic stenosis. Why? Because as systole progresses, the LV ejection velocity and the volume of blood flow across the LV increases. Hence, the ejection systolic murmur of aortic stenosis increases. Decrescendo means the murmur gradually decreases in intensity. This is the early diastolic murmur of aortic regurgitation. Why? Because as the diastole progresses, the pressure difference between the aorta and the LV decreases. Hence, regurgitation of blood from the aorta into the LV decreases as diastole progresses. Hence, the intensity of aortic regurgitation murmur also decreases. crescendo, decrescendo, or damp shaped manner. This may occur in pulmonary stenosis, commonly. And the plantar murmur, that is unchanged murmur, is damp systolic murmur of mitral regurgitation and BSD. Now, systolic murmur classification, early systolic murmur will begin with the parts of first heart sound and confined to early systolic. Mid-systolic murmurs begin after the first heart sound and end before the second heart sound. Damp systolic murmur begin with S1, occupy all of the systole and end with the second heart sound. While late systolic murmurs will begin in late to late systole, that is, they will begin after S1, they will end with S2. Early systolic murmurs are high-pitched, usually deep crescendo in configuration, they begin with S1 and end well before S2, usually at or before mid-systole. These are mostly regurgitant murmurs that occur in acute severe mitral regurgitation, acute tricuspid regurgitation at a small VSD or a large VSD with pulmonary hypertension. Remember that the cases that we see mostly in the ward are of chronic mitral regurgitation. So chronic mitral regurgitation has a damp systolic murmur. Early systolic murmur is found only in acute cases, acute mitral regurgitation, acute tricuspid regurgitation, and small VSD. Why in small VSD? Because in the later part of systole, as the LV contraction progresses, the VSD gets closed. And in a large VSD with pulmonary hypertension, the RV pressure is also high. So, as the system progresses, the difference between RV and LV pressure decreases. So, there is decreased rejection of blood through the LV, from the LV to the VSD into the RV. Hence, a large VSD with pulmonary hypertension, flow from LV to RV only occurs during the early part of systole. Hence, murmur is also heard only in the early part of systole. The mid-systolic murmurs are high to medium pitched murmurs. These are diamond shaped or spindle shaped murmurs. They begin after S1 and end before S2. The mid-systolic murmurs arise after the seminal valve opened due to rising ventricular pressure. They usually originate from the outflow tracts, that is either the LV outflow tract or the RV outflow tract. So as the flow increases with systole, the murmur increases. And then as the flow decreases with systole, the murmur decreases. That is why it is a crescendo, decrescendo, or a damp-shaped murmur. So what are the causes? Commonest are hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, pulmonary stenosis, and aortic stenosis. A hollow systolic murmur begins with S1, occupies all of the systole, and ends with S2. It is high-pitched and plateau-like in configuration. Typical examples are chronic mitral regurgitation, chronic tricuspid regurgitation, respective PSD. So this is again the chart showing the timing of these systolic murmurs and the causes. Now, differential diagnosis of a hollow systolic murmur. Supposing you hear a damp systolic murmur that it begins with S1 and ends at or just before S2. So, the three most common causes are mitral regurgitation, chronic tricuspid regurgitation, or ventricular septal defect. So, how to differentiate between three murmurs? First is where the murmur is best heard. If it is best heard at the apex, LV apex, it is originating from the mitral valve, it's mitral regurgitation. If it is best heard at the tricuspid area, it's tricuspid regurgitation. And if it is best heard in the neoaortic area, so left sternal border in the third or fourth intercostal space, it is ventricular septal defect. The mitral regurgitation murmur will radiate to axilla and back. Tricuspid regurgitation and VSD murmur will not radiate anywhere. Still will be commonest with the ventricular septal defect. The mitral regurgitation murmur is typically a plateau murmur. There is no change in this murmur with respiration. Tricuspid regurgitation murmur, since it's the right side heart event, it will increase during inspiration. A VSD murmur will increase during expiration. But on the accompanying features, mitral regurgitation, we will see a eccentric LVH, that is the LV type apex, which will be displaced downwards and outwards. There will be LVSP and intensity of first heart sound will be reduced. In tricuspid regurgitation, there will be RV enlargement. and there will be a prominent B wave in the JVP with signs of pulmonary hypertension, which will be a parastolic lift and a loud P2 and a wide split of P2. Where in BSD, we will have signs of biventricular enlargement. That is, there will be a LV apex, which will be displaced downwards and upwards. There will be a parastolic lift. There may be a along with signs of pulmonary hypertension. That is a loud P2. Right. Now coming to diastolic murmurs. Diastolic, early diastolic murmur begins with S2 confined to early diastole. A mid diastolic murmur begins at a clear interval after S2 and ends before S1. Late diastolic murmur occurs in pre-systole, that is immediately before S1. And a pan diastolic murmur that begins with S2 occupies the whole of diastole and ends with S1. So what you have to remember is early diastolic and pan diastolic murmurs are regurgitant murmurs due to flow, retrograde flow across the incompetent cellular valves. While mid diastolic and late diastolic murmurs are filling murmurs due to obstruction to flow across the retroventricular valve. So early diastolic and pan diastolic murmurs are due to cellular valve regurgitation, and mid diastolic and late diastolic murmurs are due to mostly mitral valve stenosis. So early diastolic murmurs are semilunar valve regurgitation murmurs that begin with the second heart sound. They reflect the high velocity of regurgitant backflow from the great vessels, that is, from the aorta into the left ventricle or from the pulmonary artery to the right ventricle. So the shape is decrescendo and short because it reflects the diastolic pressure gradient between the aorta or pulmonary artery, between the aorta or LV and the pulmonary artery in the RV. So as the diastole progresses, the pressure gradient between the aorta and the LV decreases, so the backflow from the aorta to LV decreases, hence the diastolic murmur intensity decreases. That is why it is a decrescendo murmur. So causes of early diastolic murmur are on the aortic regurgitation and pulmonary regurgitation. Now, a few points specifically about the early diastolic murmur in aortic regurgitation. The murmur is decrescendo. It is heard in the causes you can memorize later. How you will hear it? It is best heard in the sitting and leaning forward position with the breath held in deep expiration, but it is heard best in the neo-aortic area, that is the left sternal border in the third and fourth intercostal spaces due to valvular origin. But if it is due to aortic root etiology, then it will be heard best in the aortic area. Since clinically you will mostly get in valvular cases of aortic regurgitation, most important for you is to auscultate early diastolic murmur in the left, third and fourth intercostal space. Ask the patient to sit and lean forward, breath held in deep expiration, and with very much concentration you will have to hear the early diastolic murmur. Place the diaphragm of the stethoscope in the left, third and fourth intercostal space. Concentrate on the second heart sound, it's very easily audible there. And you will find a small murmur after the second heart sound. That will be the early diastolic murmur of aortic regurgitation. In severe aortic regurgitation of valvular etiology, there will be a functional ejection systolic murmur at the aortic area without aortic stenosis. And there will be an Austin twin murmur at the apex, along with the classic peripheral signs of aortic regurgitation. So, hollow diastolic murmur occurs in severe aortic regurgitation and pulmonary regurgitation. Mid diastolic murmurs are classical murmur is that of mitral stenosis. It is low pitched and rumbling in character. Why it is low pitched? Because the velocity of blood flow is low. So, this is a chart showing the causes of the murmurs according to the timing. Early diastolic, mid diastolic. One important thing we have to remember, pre-systolic murmur, mitral stenosis also produces a pre-systolic murmur. What is a pre-systolic murmur? That is, it will start at an interval after A2 and it will end with S1. It comes just before S1 is a pre-systolic murmur. Now, what is the etiology of mid-diastolic murmurs? Mitral stenosis is the commonest cause. Then it is followed by a tricuspid stenosis, then we have Austin twin murmur at the apex into severe aortic regurgitation. Remaining are very uncommon causes, you may not remember. how do you differentiate between this is this question is asked in your exam if you get a valvular heart disease case, and particularly if the patient has aortic regurgitation, microstenosis, which is a common combination of valve etiologies and valvular heart disease. If you see here, I'm going to ask you murmur at the apex, how to differentiate that it is due to microstenosis or it is due to Austin plain murmur. If the murmur is due to if you find a thrill at the apex, diastolic thrill at the apex, then it is most commonly due to microstenosis. Then if you hear an opening snap, it is a microstenosis. If you hear an S3, it is an Austin plain murmur. Pre-systolic accentuation of the murmur occurs in microstenosis. But in Austin plain murmur, there will be no pre-systolic accentuation. Signs of pulmonary hypertension is parasternal lip tender, loud P2. If you find, then it's microstenosis. If they are not there, then it is due to Austin plain murmur. Now, coming to continuous murmur. What is a continuous murmur? A murmur that begins in systole, continues without interruption to second heart sound, into all or a part of diastole without changing character of the murmur is defined as continuous murmur. So it may begins in systole, means it may begin with or after S1. It will continue through S2 and then it will spill into diastole and it will end with or before the second heart sound. So classical example of continuous murmur is the murmur of PDA. Another description for this murmur is train in a tunnel murmur. So if you have traveled via train and while the train moves through a tunnel, if you have heard the sound, this exactly the same reproduction of the sound is a continuous murmur of PDA. The proper name is Gibson's murmur. It is a rough machinery murmur, best heard in the left infraclavicular and pulmonary areas. What are the causes of a continuous murmur? So they have been classified into three groups. One is due to shunt, when blood flows from a high pressure chamber to a low pressure chamber. Second is due to increased blood flow. Third is due to arterial obstruction. So example of shunt is PDA and AP window. AP window is almost the same as a PDA. Then artificial shunts like the BT shunt or pot shunt that is surgically created in a patient of callous pathology. Another shunt example is Alcapa, Minotumimusen. Then due to rapid blood flow, the cervical venous hum, mammary shoot play, hyperthyroidism, this is hyperemia or neoplasm, renal cell carcinoma or hepatoma or a hemangioma. And due to localized arterial obstruction, we will find a continuous murmur. Commonest example is coarctation of aorta. Others are femoral artery occlusion over the femoral artery, carotid occlusion over the carotids, and branch pulmonary artery stenosis. We will hear it in the left third intercostal space. So, come to the end of the class. If you have any questions, you may put it up in the chat section.
Madam, there is a question. Why A2 is absent in severe pulmonary stenosis?
A2 is not absent. There is a slash and it's written undetectable. So it's a severe pulmonary stenosis, but this thing, the valve is flywheel. One cause is your P2 is loud. Second is the A2 merges with the P2. Second is the murmur of pulmonary stenosis is so long, the A2 becomes enveloped in that murmur. That is why A2 is not detectable. It's not that A2 is absent.
Madam, why with Valsalva HOCM murmur increases?
Because the LVOT obstruction, I have prepared a chart for you, but I skipped the chart intentionally because the Valsalva of this thing maneuver is too much to explain. The HOCM murmur is the only murmur that behaves in a opposite manner as compared to the murmur of aortic stenosis. When you do Valsalva, there is in the initial phase, the strain phase, there is decreased venous return and everything decreases. So the aortic stenosis murmur will decrease. But in case of HOCM, the LVOT obstruction increases by doing Valsalva. Hence, the murmur increases.
No,
don't go for isometric hand grip and Valsalva and all murmurs, and don't talk about them this thing routinely in your this thing, the murmur examination, or because if you do not understand them in very much detail, when the examiner goes into the detail of it, then you will land in a soup. So don't volunteer information regarding this dynamic auscultation of isometric hand grip and Valsalva unless you are asked for, because it's a difficult topic, and they will, if the examiner goes in detail, then you may land in a problem. Yes, there is a general rule about how they affect heart murmurs, which does not apply to this thing, HOCM, and usually does not apply to HOCM. Isometric hand grip will increase the cardiac output and increase blood flow. So most of the left-sided heart murmurs will increase, and then followed by the right-sided heart murmurs. In the strain phase of Valsalva maneuver, there will be decreased venous return and decreased cardiac output. So the most of the heart murmurs and will decrease in intensity, excepting the murmur of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, where the LV gradient increases further on doing Valsalva. Hence the HOCM murmur increases. But the pathophysiology is a very long and complicated one of Valsalva and HOCM. The same thing, mitral valve prolapse, as long as there is a lot of blood in the left ventricle, the valve does not fall back into the left ventricle. Prolapse means the valve is falling back into the left ventricle. So if there is a lot of blood in the left ventricle, the valve floats. That is why prolapse does not occur. Hence, the murmur of mitral valve prolapse is not heard. The murmur of mitral valve prolapse is lesser in intensity. But as soon as you perform Valsalva, the amount of blood in the left ventricle decreases. So the valve is unable to float anymore. It soon collapses into the left ventricle. Hence, the murmur of mitral valve prolapse increases.
Okay. Do anyone has any more questions?
I think we should end. Okay.
Yes, sir. I think no more questions there.
Uploaded in YouTube by tomorrow. If there is any more questions after going through the YouTube presentation, you can put it in the YouTube channel, and I think Dr. Sonali will try to answer them. Okay. So we are thanking Dr. Sonali, and we should end now.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.